having me come. I haven't had the pleasure of meeting you, but I'm Cheryl. I like talking about leukemia, something that even before my fellowship, I actually worked internationally trying to optimize leukemia protocols, and my current research is on genetics of a specific type of leukemia, so something I'm certainly happy to talk about, and please feel free to interrupt me sort of as we go through with any questions or anything like that. So given our focus on emergency medicine, I'm going to talk about sort of kids who come in through the emergency room, new diagnosis of leukemia, and then a little bit of what the rest of the beyond the emergency room looks like as well. But I'm going to talk about clinical presentation, how we diagnose kids that have leukemia, and then a very, very bird's eye sort of overview of treatments and what happens after people leave the emergency room. And sort of to do this, I'm just going to go through definitions, what presentation looks like, and focusing on what really needs to happen in the emergency room. And then how we start diagnosis there, move on to confirmatory diagnosis after admission, some of what we think about in the differential, and then, as I mentioned, a broad treatment overview. And then I have some pieces. I think that's a good way to go. So leukemia is, as you guys know, a blood cancer, and that's sort of all a lot of people know about it when they come in. Leuk means white, so it's a cancer specifically of the white blood cells. It's the most common type of cancer that we see in children, around 3,000 new cases of acute leukemia a year. Acute is much more common in children, chronic leukemia being much more common in adults. Acute does mean that the symptoms have usually been going on between sort of days to weeks, and within months, an untreated patient with acute leukemia will usually not be alive anymore if they haven't received treatment, whereas so chronic leukemia is a much more indolent form of leukemia, more commonly seen in adults, much more commonly, and that is a very slow-growing disease that even without treatment for years, patients still are alive. The peak incidence of acute leukemia is between 2 and 5 years of age, so certainly we see a lot of toddlers with leukemia. So what leukemia actually is, so we know that there's three different types of blood cells, platelets, red blood cells, and white blood cells that are all made in the bone marrow. They come from the stem cells that are in our bone marrow, and the sort of precursors, an early precursor to mature white blood cells, well, to any white blood cell, to any blood cell, is called a blast. So megakaryoblasts are early platelets. Proerythroblasts are early red blood cells, and then the white blood cells, if they're going to be in myeloid differentiation, are myeloblasts, and lymphoblasts are early lymphocytes. The lymphoblasts are what make acute lymphoblastic leukemia, or ALL, which is the most common type of acute leukemia in children. And so that's what we're looking for when they read out the differential, and inevitably the majority of these patients come in the middle of the night, and that's what we're looking for on this smear. How does a blast turn into a leukemia cell? So blasts are normal, we all have them in our bone marrow because that's what makes the mature white blood cells, but in leukemia, one of these blasts or immature white blood cells gets stuck in that immature phase. There's a genetic change within a single blast initially, and that makes it stuck in the immature phase and also makes it divide and divide and divide, and that's where the leukemia comes from. So these, because it's a single cell that's dividing, they're clonal, which means they all look the same and have the same genetics, at least initially. And so as those clonal cells fill up the bone marrow, there's no room for the normal cells, which is why patients often present with cytopenias. And then normally there should be no blasts in the periphery. They should all be in the bone marrow. If there's a lot of them, like if you have leukemia, then they'll start to spill into the peripheral blood. There are other cases in which blasts go into the peripheral blood where the bone marrow is particularly active. So if you, for example, have a severe infection that you're recovering from and you're sort of churning out, trying to churn out a lot of white blood cells to actually fight the infection, you may have maybe one or two blasts on your peripheral smear when you look, and that may be normal, but certainly any more than that or without that particular history is concerning for leukemia. So how do these patients that we then take to Red and Aqua present? So it's usually with signs and symptoms of the cytopenia that they get from the normal cells being crowded out. So if your white blood cells are low, you get infection. If your red blood cells are low, you get symptoms of anemia, fatigue, and pallor. If your platelets are low, then maybe you'll ooze, have fatigue, GI bruising. Cancer is also a whole body inflammation. So some of the signs and symptoms are just of that inflammatory response that we have. So fever is being sort of the most well-known weight loss through a similar cytokine mechanism. And then you can also get leukemic infiltration. So meaning you have a whole bunch of leukemia cells. So that's, we know that that happens in the bone marrow, and that's where they're starting and dividing and dividing. And you can actually get bone marrow expansion. So kids will often come in with bony pain, sometimes even in one particular location, because the bone marrow has literally expanded and is pushing out on the normal bone, and that causes bone pain. But you can also get leukemic infiltration into other organs. So classically, kids present with hepatosplenomegaly. There's immune cells in there that that the blasts go to, and so that causes organomegaly. The other sort of classic findings from this, you may have sort of liver dysfunction on a CMP if there's liver infiltration, or renal dysfunction for the same reason. You can get CNS involvement if the outside of the bone marrow in general is called extramedullary leukemic involvement. And there are patients who present not only with headache, but sometimes with focal neurologic findings. Less common with classic ALL and more common with other types of leukemia, but does certainly happen, especially in older children. And then abdominal pain, either from hepatosplenomegaly, renal involvement, or sort of pressure of expansion of organs. So all of these things, especially fever, bone pain, are pretty nonspecific. They certainly overlap a lot with infection, and patients, because they don't have a normal immune system, often do present with infection. So then when do you actually suspect leukemia from that? So we use the CBC primarily to say there should be at least more than one cell line down, two or more of the three cell lines should be abnormal, suggesting that in addition to these sort of systemic things that we can see, there's something going on in the bone marrow. These non-specific symptoms are classically called B symptoms. That's a phrase that's used more in adults than in kids, and it came from, there was like, when people were deciding what leukemia was before there were any sort of genetic tests or much knowledge of blasts at all, there were literally a list of symptoms that were A symptoms and B symptoms, and people with leukemia got B symptoms, and so fever, weight loss, organomegaly are B symptoms for that reason, and sort of historical nomenclature. So why do these kids end up in the emergency room, and always end up getting admitted if we're really worried about acute leukemia and come in after coming in at 3 a.m? So all pediatric cases of acute leukemia that are urgently treated, which here in almost all pediatric centers across the country means that they will end up getting admitted. That's not the same for solid tumors or other types of malignancy, and there are rare exceptions to this. That's typically true. The reason for that is a couple of things. So we know that there's cell line abnormalities. All three cell lines are affected. In some cases, more and more rare, as there's more screening CBCs done to catch these a little bit early, you can get infections. So for patients who have a very low normal white blood cell count, they're obviously neutropenic. But even for kids who have a normal neutrophil count at the time of diagnosis, it's thought that those cells don't function properly, and so everyone who has a newly diagnosed leukemia is considered functionally neutropenic for that reason. And there have been many times that kids have come in with infections are very common, but actually being bacteremic or septic at time of leukemic presentation is not uncommon either, particularly when people live further from medical care. Hyperleukocytosis is considered an oncologic emergency. So you can present with cytopenia, like we talked about, where your white blood cell count is down because it's being crowded out by leukemia. But your white blood cell count may also be high because it's being read as high because you just have so many blasts. And so that's leukocytosis. Hyperleukocytosis is when you have a white blood cell count of greater than 100. And that's dangerous because when your blood is very viscous from a lot of white blood cells, and leukemia cells, blasts in particular, are very sticky and stick to blood vessels, they clog up areas where there are small blood vessels, importantly the brain. And so if you have hyperleukocytosis, that's considered an emergency in order to prevent stroke and proper oxygenation to the lungs. Bleeding is for specific kinds of AML can be, of leukemia, of certain type of AML called acute promyelocytic leukemia, or APL, very frequently presents with fatal intracranial hemorrhage at first presentation, and so bleeding can also be an emergency, particularly if you don't know what kind of leukemia you're treating with. Tumor lysis syndrome is the thing that we sort of treat everyone for, and one of the reasons we keep people in the hospital here, even if they're generally healthy. And because it's so common, I'm just talk about that a little bit more. So tumor lysis syndrome is just a bunch of metabolic abnormalities that are related to when malignant cells lyse. So inside our cell, we have a whole bunch of stuff, as we know. Importantly for this, that includes potassium, phosphorus, and DNA. So when you have cells that quickly turn over and quickly die, which leukemia cells do, they're more fragile than normal cells. So a normal white blood cell will last about a week, and leukemia cells last much shorter than that, anywhere from a few hours to a couple of days. And so they're turning over very quickly, and then all the things that were inside the cell or outside the cell, the nucleic acids get broken down, and then you're left with a lot of PFAS and uric acid floating around in your blood. And subsequently to the high FOS, you get a secondary low calcium. So this is bad, first usually because it will make your kidneys fail. So if you have high uric acid, that will very quickly precipitate into your renal tubules and cause renal failure. If you have high potassium, which happens certainly not just in tumor lysis, but we worry about for a lot of cardiac patients and other things, you can get arrhythmias. High FOS will collect calcium and make calcium phosphorus precipitate in the renal tubules, and will actually can also cause renal failure. And then low calcium, most emergently, will cause seizures, although it can also cause a variety of other things that I learned about when I was doing OBs, pregnant women with preeclampsia get this, but anorexia, emesis, spasms, and tinnitus. So you're at increased risk for tumor lysis if you have an increased number of cells that are breaking down. So either you have a lot of white blood cells that can break down, you have hyperleukocytosis, or you have a specific type of tumor that dies quickly, multiplies faster and dies faster. Burkitt's lymphoma is very classic for this. It'll very quickly go from a barely palpable node to a huge mass, even within the matter of days. And patients who have quickly turning over tumors, including that, and others are at increased risk for tumor lysis. And then most of these things that are a problem with tumor lysis affect the kidney. And so if you already have an issue with the kidney, then you're more at risk for the end game of tumor lysis that we're watching for. And so children with renal impairment are more prone for that reason. And that includes patients who come in with leukemic infiltrate in the kidneys, which is not uncommon. So how do we diagnose patients that come into the emergency room? So the first thing we always do, people always tell us about when they call us, is looking at the CBC. As I mentioned, looking at how many cell lines are abnormal, and then looking at the peripheral smear to actually look for the leukemia cells themselves. We look for other evidence of leukemia, the other organ systems that can be involved, as I mentioned, the CMP, coags, because of liver functions, as well as certain types of leukemia that can present with coagulopathy. LDH is a very non-specific marker of cell turnover, so also my patients with sickle cell will have a high LDH because they're hemolyzing their red blood cells, but it does tell us sort of a risk for tumor lysis if we do think that it, the context is leukemia. Uric acid we always look at because it's dangerous in high levels, and so we want to know. And then chest x-ray, because leukemia can be associated with a mediastinal mass, and if that's the case, we want to know sooner rather than later because that can potentially cause airway compromise and issues. And then we also, because we need to sometimes treat emergently, look for tumor lysis syndrome in the ED as well, the chemistries of uric acid that I mentioned. So the biggest thing that the fellow or attending is asked to do when they come to the emergency room is look at a smear to see if they see any leukemia cells. So on the left is a normal smear. So platelets and a couple different kinds of white blood cells, neutrophils and lymphocytes. That's actually a pretty big lymphocyte for a normal lymphocyte, but it has a lot of cytoplasm all around the nucleus. So if you look on the right, the density of red blood cells is smaller, so the patient is somewhat anemic. There's like one platelet that I can see, so the patient's thrombocytopenic. And you can see that there's a bunch of cells that look very similar to each other, which is always concerning. And even on low power, when you see a bunch of this purpley blue, is always a foreboding sign that you can see a bunch of cells. These are lymphoblasts that have a very high nuclear cytoplasmic ratio. What doesn't show very well on here is that they have very fine, immature looking chromatin, and then exactly what the morphology looks like varies by type of leukemia. This is just comparing a blast, an immature cell to a mature lymphocyte, and the blast shouldn't be in the periphery. So how do we sort of acutely manage as we're working these kids up so that based on the same wave that we diagnose? So looking at the CBC is usually what prompts a call to us. And a lot of what we're there for, in addition to sort of looking at the smear, which is certainly not an oncologist-specific thing, and saying, yes, I think there actually is leukemia, is really just being supportive to the family. Just like if my kid had went into renal failure, I'd want to talk to a renal doctor. Most people who find out they have leukemia want to talk to an oncologist. And so I feel like that's my biggest role when I come into the emergency room, is just to support the family and sort of transition them into the next few hours. Sometimes there are cytopenias that require emergent transfusions. There's only been once, I think, in the past year of my new patients that this has needed to happen in the ED, and it's in cases where there's cardiac compromise secondary to severe cytopenias, then of course you're getting blood going as soon as possible. Usually these will wait until they get up to the floor. And then other effects of leukemia. So if patients have fever, as I mentioned, they can present bacteremic and sometimes in septic shock even. So all patients get a blood culture and then they're started on broad spectrum antibiotics. Specifically, we cover for the things that will kill you the fastest. So gram-negative rods and pseudomonas, so we'll always use an anti-pseudomonal agent. We usually start with cefepime as the national standard currently, although that's changed over the past couple of years for patients who are newly diagnosed with leukemia. Coagulopathies, as I mentioned, particularly in certain kinds of leukemia, can sometimes be fatal, and so those sometimes need rapid correction. Knowing about liver and renal dysfunction is mostly acutely for dosing of drugs and fluids, although rarely that needs more emergent intervention and sometimes dialysis. And then mediastinal mass is often something as simple as just taking airway precautions and getting an echo before anesthesia to make sure that there's not going to be any issues. Sometimes we do have children that have immediate airway compromise and require emergent treatment, which is most often now radiation is how we do emergent treatment for mediastinal masses. because you can be very specific about where you give emergent radiation, and you can potentially even leave a window untreated so that you can get a biopsy from there later. In some cases, chemo is used, and particularly if it's a time of day when you can't get emergent radiation. And then tumor lysis syndrome, we start everyone on 1.5 to 2 times maintenance fluids to sort of flush out and all of the tumor lysis products, and don't put anything in it that could be coming out of the cells, so no pain, no FOS ever in the fluids. And then if there's specific abnormalities, high uric acid, there's specific drugs that we can use to target the urate pathway. Hyperkalemia, similar to other hyperkalemia, whether it's KS, laid out buterol, et cetera. And so those things sometimes use emergent intervention as well. So at that point, the kids typically come upstairs, and over the next 24 hours, we usually get confirmation that the diagnosis is actually leukemia or whatever else it is. So this involves getting a bone marrow aspiration, so actually pulling bone marrow, the liquid part of the center of the bone, out, which we do in the hip, because in kids who are haven't gained the same amount of adipose as the rest of us over time, that's a very easily accessible place. In adults, they will sometimes do there, they'll sometimes often do the sternum, actually, for a similar reason, particularly in men. In adults, this is always done awake, or almost always done awake. In kids, we do under anesthesia. Both for comfort as well as to help them hold still, although rarely we do it awake. And from that, we look at morphology, which just is what the cells look like under the microscope, sort of from the source rather than from the peripheral blood. We run flow cytometry, which looks at the specific protein markers on the cells. So we, every cell at every phase of maturity has different protein markers, and so there are certain protein markers that will tell us, okay, this is a B leukemia versus a T leukemia. And then we also run cytogenetics. Those take a couple of weeks to come back, typically. And that is looking at the genetic makeup of the leukemic cell itself rather than somatic genetics. And that gives us a lot of prognostic information, and certainly over the next few years will give us more information about specifically how to treat both targeted therapies as well as just prognostic information. For our family. Everyone at diagnosis gets an LP to look at whether or not there is a visible leukemic blast in the CNS. I always preface this to families by saying that we know that there's some there even if we can't see them, that blood goes everywhere, but we know that the blood-brain barrier does a little bit of protecting the CNS from blood everywhere else, and so if there's enough leukemia cells in the CNS that they're visible, then we upgrade the CNS treatment that children with leukemia get. And then I mentioned children also come in with pain in certain bones or other places. In addition to sort of bone marrow expansion, you can get pathologic fractures, both because the bones get weak as the bone marrow expands and makes the cortex smaller, but you also are often osteopenic when you're diagnosed. And you can see, even on plain film, you can often see bone marrow involvement, although you can see it very specifically on MRI, as well as obviously just looking for fractures. So when we say leukemia is a very broad term that encompasses multiple different subtypes of leukemia, the most common of which is acute lymphoblastic leukemia, where it's the lymphoblast, the lymphocyte precursor that it becomes leukemic. This is the majority of pediatric leukemias and can be subdivided into B and T cell ALL. B cell, so B cell precursor ALL is the most common type of leukemia and the most common type of cancer actually in children. Luckily, that means we have a lot of experience and are very good at treating it. But there's also T cell, which is more likely to present with a mediastinal mass and more likely in older kids. The second most common type of leukemia that, in general, is acute myeloid leukemia, or AML, which is about 20% of pediatric leukemia. and is treated differently, as I'll sort of briefly go over, and is more difficult to treat. And then the remainder, since that doesn't add up to 100%, are more rare subclasses of leukemia. So what else may we be looking for? So there's certainly other malignancies that involve the bone marrow, go to the bone marrow. Lymphoma is one of them. Neuroblastoma is another small round blue cell tumor that makes nests within the bone marrow and can therefore present with cytopenias. Similarly, retinoblastoma. Medulloblastoma, which is a brain tumor, and so will often present with mass effect in the CNS as well. Rhabdomyosarcoma. And then there's non-malignant etiology. So aplastic anemia, either genetic or acquired, can cause, it's called anemia, but actually can cause pancytopenia eventually. And patients who we've had as sort of potential leukemia patients who've turned out to have aplastic anemia are often initially relieved. And to be honest, it's actually more difficult to cure aplastic anemia than it is to cure a standard BBALL toddler. Because aplastic anemia cure actually involves always blood marrow transplant. There's multiple autoimmune cytopenias, and infections, as I mentioned, can have a couple of blasts peripherally, but will also cause pan bone marrow suppression, and so you can get mild pancytopenia just from infection alone. So then once we have a definitive diagnosis of some type of leukemia, there's a lot of long discussion with families. Obviously, the full-time and supportive care for whatever pain patients have, which usually the pain improves actually after treatment, often within the first 48 hours, and transfusions as needed. The other thing that happens usually within the first 48 hours is getting a central line placed so that we can start chemotherapy, and then whatever baseline studies that need to happen before chemotherapy. So just briefly, sort of what the treatment for the most common types of leukemia look like. So ALL is a very long treatment. It's somewhere between 2 and 3.5 years. Every phase of therapy has its own funny name, which are what is written here. But the first sort of 6 to 8 months are the more intense chemotherapy, where patients are in and out of the hospital, are more immune suppressed. And these different phases, everyone starts with induction, the point of induction. At the end of induction, you try to induce remission, which means you don't have any visible leukemia cells, hopefully at the end of the first month. There's usually a consolidation afterwards, and then sometimes, depending on the type of leukemia, these other phases change slightly. The last 1.5 to 3 years is what's called maintenance, which is trying to keep the leukemia away. And this is mostly at home. This is the time when like kids look like themselves again. Their hair comes back during this phase. They can go back to school. They come see us once a month for IV chemotherapy, just in the clinic, just to push. Otherwise, it's oral chemotherapy at home. And then every 3 months, they have a lumbar puncture with IT chemotherapy. AML is quite different in how it's treated. So instead of a very long treatment course, it has a much more intensive, in its myelosuppression, about 6 to 9 months, less than a year of therapy with sort of upfront induction, and then any number of sort of cycles of chemotherapy before either going to hematopoietic stem cell transplant, bone marrow transplant, or various different regimens based on a lot of different risk factors and genetic makeup. So then I have a few cases that are all kids who have presented in the past few months, but any questions? All right, so these are pretty short. So first case is 5-year-old who was transferred to us from the place that you never want to be, OSH, for what was billed as a rule-out leukemia.